Testing. Oh, that was very
okay, everyone,
quiet.
We're going to get started with this panel. If folks could move to the front, that would be great. We would
gonna
so appreciate it.
Get all intimate and close and build relationships and everything. It's going to be great.
You know, talk. Great. So we're going to give a quick intro, and then we're going to invite the panelists to join us. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Breaking the Binary. Thank you for being here. Let's give a little love for the event.
Woo!
Yeah. Awesome. My name is SK. I use they, them pronouns. I'm a co-founder of this Breaking the Binary situation we got going on.
My name is Lisa. I also use they and them pronouns. Co-founder of Breaking the Binary. This is so weird to say also.
Oh. I know. But we, you know, we've really created that hashtag to describe a bunch of different types of events and work with theater arts organizations to create sustainable practices for trans, gender, non-conforming, non-binary, genderqueer, two-spirit, and many other non-cisgender identities. Inclusion work with folks. So that's kind of what this is a part of. Yeah, should we go into how this day is going to go?
Let's do it.
Great. Awesome. I'll do it. So we're going to kick it off with a panel it'll be about an hour of different arts workers plugging into this conversation from a bunch of different perspectives and from specifically a kind of trans umbrella perspective, which is great, and Lisa's going to be leading that conversation. After that, we're going to transition into some working conversations about the panel and about strategizing for the field and kind of for the world in general. And sort of depending on, you know, the needs of the space and how we're doing, that might be two separate groups, that might be one big group as well. At that point, we'll say goodbye to our friends at HowlRound. Hey, HowlRound.
Hey.
We're live streaming this right now. And then we'll have a reception. And we'd also love to point out the altar space in the corner. Do you want to talk
about
that?
Yeah, sure. So this is our Honor the Dead, Fight Like Hell for the Living. I don't know about y'all, but what's happening in the world right now, I feel like we need to be holding space specifically for those of us that experience the most systemic marginalization and violence from the state. And so up on this altar, we have flowers, we have some LED candles, because I know that, you know, having actual fire in a very enclosed space is probably not safe. But also some amazing books by trans people of color authors, a couple of volumes, so if you want to go up and take a peek. And then we also have on the left side our space to offer words. So what words of support, of healing, of resistance do you want to offer to the community right now, specifically thinking about who of us is being most targeted. And so there's space to offer those. Feel free, there's some chalk if you want to write on the chalkboard behind it. And really, if any point, if you just want to take a step and have some space, that is open. It'll be up for the rest of the day.
Great, cool. We want to give out a few thank yous before we get started. Big thank you to all of our panelists and facilitators. Took a lot of, you know, relationship building to get folks in this room, so we're super grateful for people doing the work. Thank you to American Repertory Theater for supporting this whole initiative and being open around their sort of, you know, programming with trans identities, of just reaching out and saying, help, we want to have a conversation, we want support around this work, which is awesome. Want to give a special thanks to the staff at Oberon, special thanks to Brenna, very special thanks to Mark Lunsford. Also to HowlRound for live streaming. Regina Fields for writing an awesome interview article about the event. Mm-hmm. And I think that's it.
I think that rounds it.
Yeah. Cool. So we'll transition into the panel. Just want to say thank you so much for showing up. The context that we're in, sort of politically and in this country right now, is like really frightening and hard, and you know, we understand that it takes a lot to show up and to continue to believe in the arts as a form of resistance. Just want to name that. So thank you for being here, and we'll start that panel off.
Cool, sweet, thank you all. So I'd like to invite up our panelists. Come on down. I'm going to put a mic down that is not mine and switch. Okay, well, does this work? Oh yeah, there we go, it's hot. So first off, again, I know I've like thanked all of you.
I can sit on the stage.
Oh, wait, we can grab, is there a spare chair? We're gonna get a spare chair. Okay, cool. Yay!
Thank you very much.
Matches the chair, we like matching up here. It's wonderful and beautiful. So just to start off, what I'd like to do is actually just go down and for folks to share your name, your pronouns, and the work you do in relationship to the arts and also just to the world. That's a very large question, but if there's anything aside from your relationship to the arts that you're like, I want to call this out, absolutely feel free. I'm going to ask that folks try to keep it to 2 minutes so we can dive on in. Cool? You down to start us off?
Yeah, I won't even take 2 minutes. Yeah,
also, please use the mic.
Oh, yeah, use the mic because HowlRound's live streaming.
Live stream.
I'm P. Carl. I go by Carl, he and him pronouns. I'm the co-artistic director at Arts Emerson at Emerson College. I'm also the director of HowlRound. I'm currently I like to call myself a part of the resistance. There we go.
Hello, my name is Vic. My pronouns are they and them. Currently, I'm a grad student in an arts and education master's program, but I spent a lot of time in the stage management production area of theater, just kind of trying to fit that whole institution into my growth and identity work and how it relates to the communities that I'm a part of, and also figuring out how to work for those people.
Hi, my name's Lexi. I'm the managing director of Peacock Rebellion. We are a queer and trans people of color arts organization using comedy for social justice. I do stand up and poetry, and we're based out of Oakland, California.
Hi, my name's Kat Nakaji. I'm the production supervisor for pedagogical programs at the ART and Harvard University. I work with the Harvard undergraduates, particularly the Harvard Radcliffe Dramatic Club, and then the graduate program, the Institute for Advanced Theater Training at the American Repertory Theater. I love acronyms, it's my whole life. And beyond that, doing a lot of activism work. I come from a background of carpentry and props crafting, so definitely a production end into theater.
Hi, my name is Nick. I use they, them pronouns. I'm a transdisciplinary artist, and what was the other half of the question?
I think like relationship you do the arts or anything else you want to offer into the space.
Oh, I'm a transdisciplinary artist. I've been an arts administrator. I just, any way that I could have gotten into making work and figuring out how to talk to people and relate to people, I've done it all as best as I could.
Well, that actually leads us perfectly into our first question. So I think my experience with theater as somebody who came to theater in really weird ways, the running joke at my job currently is that I'm a history major who just really loved theater and never took any classes and just did a lot of plays. So what I'd actually like to do and offer to the space is talking a little bit about, and these questions are also open for anybody who would like to answer them. We don't necessarily have to go down the road. But just how did you get why did you come to the arts? How did you get to the arts? What brought you to the place that you are? And I think also, how has that affected your analysis and how it shows up in your work? I ask very long questions.
I can start because I thought about this before I got up here. No shade. So when I was really, really young, my mom essentially threw me into theater, even though with all my resistance. And I was doing a lot of plays up until high school. And that's really when I started to question my gender and my sexuality and really shifted into community organizing, primarily queer and trans youth in high schools in California. And then I got sucked into a lot of nonprofit movement work, and that is when I found Peacock Rebellion, or Peacock Rebellion kind of found me. And in 2014, we had our first stand-up comedy training program, which Lisa was also a part of. And I was a part of that cohort, but didn't get to finish as there was some transphobia that was coming up and some other difficult things. And so the cohort continued to move on and the program moved on. And the following year, we put together an all trans women of color comedy-based storytelling show, which I was invited to produce with Debbie, our ED and artistic director. And that is when I kind of started to see the magic of the Peacock Rebellion that we do, and the way that we really use comedy and art for social justice and for making people uncomfortable and challenging them. And, you know, building community, but also healing queer and trans people of color who go to our shows, who have to hold so much trauma that they experience on the daily. And also even the ways that, like, our artists get to heal and perform. And if you saw our show on Friday, you kind of get an idea of that. Yeah, it's great, and like we work really hard with our community, and it's not always easy, but we do it anyway. And yeah, it's just been a magical, hectic ride since that point. But yeah, that's me.
For me, I grew up in a place or like in a community or family where children were supposed to be seen and not heard. So for me, art was always a way to like have a voice and to exercise my sort of like resistance against my family structure and like this world that was like not valuing me as like a whole being. I had a lot to say, even as a very small kid, you know? So it was constantly this sort of like, how do I push back, but also push back without like getting in trouble all the time. So like, you know, finding that comedic timing, finding how to like allure the people that were around me. And I really got into, during my middle school years, I was in Catholic school for most of my life. So around like middle school, I was like, I need to find myself. I was like, this one summer, I was like, I really need to find myself. I went to the library and I took out The Red Balloon, really great movie, and I saw The Hours, and I just was like, I need to be an actor. I was like, I like was in plays and stuff, you know what I mean, in church and stuff like that, but it was more like pageantry, you know what I mean? But after watching The Hours, I was like, that's it. I am gonna be an actor. And I was already like dancing in my own time, but didn't really feel confident about like my movement. And that was really it. After that, I was just like super determined, and I, behind my parents' back, started marking off all of the performing arts high schools I was gonna go to. But they were already like, you're gonna go to an all-girls high school, blah, blah, blah. And I worked really hard to get all the paperwork together and like audition for the school. First time I didn't get in, I was crushed. I had to go to an all-girls school for freshman year, and then I got into the school. And that was really it, you know, like I did a bunch of things after that, but really that was my entry point, just trying to like resist my family structure, which I knew, you know, I didn't have a full consciousness of it as a small child, but I knew that I wasn't going to be able to exist in the way that I wanted to if I didn't find a way to have a voice, and really through the arts is where I was able to like cultivate that.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to read?
Oh. I was going to say, yeah, and similar in high school, that's when I like found theater because they would let you play with power tools there. And how great is that? So just coming into theater and getting able to work on things, build things with my hands, because it was a safe space where you got to be who you are and you could be a different person or you could be a character, and I loved that, and you could create a whole other world on stage, and that was magical to me growing up. And then it was also kind of sad because immediately I had a really great high school that put us in contact with theater professionals in the area, and getting out to going to see professional shows and going to calls and working on professional calls and immediately seeing that othering of walking into a room and being, oh, I'm the only person of color here. I think I may also be the only queer person here. And just that dichotomy of like feeling this incredible, safe, magical space, and then all of a sudden being really isolated was an interesting entry into theater. And that's sort of a discourse that's continued.
Yeah, I just add, I mean, I came to the arts, you know, because I'm obsessed with stories. I've been interested in and saved by stories my whole life. I sort of grew up in a in the public library. I spent all my time in the library reading. I feel like theater for me has been an opportunity to at least find some space to imagine the possibilities of existing. I think erasure is so intense in the trans community. It's just, you really can't find yourself anywhere. So I think in a way, I'm in the arts, I've been sort of looking my whole life to find some mirroring back, which almost never happens. And so now we're in this weird moment of 2017. I'm old now. And suddenly some of these stories are starting to pop up. It's really it's quite stunning. I've been in theater, you know, over 20 years, and it's actually taken this long to even imagine a story that connects in some way to my life. And if you can imagine how long I've been obsessed with stories and how long I've waited for that, it's sort of mind-blowing. So hence I'm in the arts as the one space where that, you know, those stories might exist. So
for me, it was also around high school, I think, that I saw a play at my school. It was the Laramie Project, and I had actually gotten invited by my friend who was in it, and she was like, you can come with me, but you have to come early because I have to be there. And I was like, that makes sense. So I got to like hang out while, you know, she was getting ready, and I kind of just got to see the magic happen, I guess, behind the scenes, and then to see it, and then, you know, it was complex because it was, you know, the story about this white gay boy who had been murdered, but who was not me, but just seeing a story about a gay character come to life, and I had seen it kind of erupt from nothing, having been there with her call time, was really interesting. And so I went to the theater director of our high school program, and I was like, I want to do that. I was like, I don't want to be on the stage, though, but like, I have good like list making skills. How can I use those? And so I figured out from there, basically in high school, that I wanted to be a part of making stories that could somehow, maybe possibly at some point, represent people that also looked like me. And I went through college, and I didn't really enjoy my program or the people in it because they didn't really give me that that sense of, oh, this is, you know, these are stories for people about me, or like marginalized communities that can also serve as healing. I didn't really get that from my program. So I ended up doing a lot of outside work, which ended up, so I got to see a lot of building, production, but then in turn, my friends and family wouldn't be able to see it because then it would be too expensive. So I started thinking a lot about accessibility in the theater work that I was doing or becoming a part of. And so I think just over time, it's kind of molded from this wanting to see stories built with representation that was also really accessible. And so I kind of just keep trying to build on what I've learned so far in that area.
Yeah, thank you all so much. And I think some of that comes to like hearing a lot of key themes of like, what was the first like place that felt safe, right? So what was the first place that like showed you that this thing could exist? And I think Kat, what you were bringing up in terms of like finding that safe place and then kind of getting thrust into spaces that you're like, this is still the thing I love, but this doesn't feel like my space anymore. And so I think especially when we're talking about like trans spectrum folks and access to arts institutions, there isn't necessarily traditional career paths for us or like traditional access points. And so I'd love to just hear from folks, and this is also just an opportunity to show love to people and organizations that you're like, everybody should know about this. But what institutions or organizations or people do you think were formative in developing your artistic practice or career? And I think specifically, kind of getting back to what I feel like folks touched on, what were those things or people that really were like, I exist, I can exist here?
I thought about this question, and there was one person that was like, oh my gosh, I need to talk about Sunil Swarup. He was a professor at Emerson College, or is, I'm not quite sure, I have to check the resume. And I was in a queer theater class when I was at Emerson College, and we did an advised piece, and it was one of those just magical moments where the piece, I'm sure, was a devised piece done by college students, so it's probably not going to win a Tony, but it was so important to be part of that process and to suddenly be surrounded in a room and feel like I could see myself and everyone, and we were sharing these stories and sharing experiences, and it was a really amazing moment for me in theater and with art to be like, once again, creating that safe space and seeing, as Carl mentioned, the mirroring of like a story that was personal to me was really amazing. And he also has a line that I've stolen from his, which is, I'm asking, not telling, when discussing things. I'm asking you this, but I'm not telling you what to think. And that has been a really important conversation in my life.
Thank you.
There's a few things. So once again, at the public library, my babysitter took us to the library, so it was like the hangout spot. There was a reenactment of like, during Black History Month, of like Sojourner Truth's story. It blew my mind. I was like, this is really awesome. And that was like a possibility model. So high school was really tough because it was like, my drama teachers had like no idea, I guess, about like Black theater. So it was just, we did not have, me and like two other people of color in the class just didn't have roles that we could grapple with. And like, I mean, and it was wonderful to do other things, you know, I like Bug, I like all these other things that we got to do, but it didn't prepare us for what the reality would be once we were outside of the school. So I went to this gay after school program where we did sort of youth devised pieces around STDs and STIs and how to talk to young people. Shout out to E. Dale Smith, who was the leader of that program dramaturgically. Was amazing. It was like devised. I played, I was in a one person show where I played this drag queen who conceptually, like in his framework, started the Stonewall riots. At this point, I really didn't even know about gay history. You know, like I was like 16 years old, trying to grapple with coming out, and got this opportunity to also play with gender, which I didn't really even know at the time, but I wasn't wearing makeup, and I was like in full drag, and it was amazing. So that was a really awesome time. And another one that comes to mind is being in Chicago, meeting SK, and at a queer party, and talking about my history, and being like, I would love to intern at the time About Face Theater. And that was a really huge moment for me because I got to help produce and develop and administratively like support art, which now is invaluable for having my own career and creative business. I would have never had the ability to do those sort of things. So those are some people that I hold dear to my heart and experiences.
Thank you. I guess I'll go next. So definitely Debbie, who is here, over there. being a beacon and guide and herder of queer and trans folks of color in the Bay, who have been burnt out and chewed up and thrown out by the nonprofit industrial complex, and teaching me, at least, really new ways about how to engage with community-based work and liberation work, and really learning how to undo a lot of the harm and trauma that's been done by these nonprofits and organizations that are based in communities and movements, and shifting that into something that's healing for me and something that is also positive for my community. And also, especially, I agree with what Nick said about being an arts administrator, being able to bring in people who haven't had an opportunity to perform or to explore art, and working with a cohort of 8 trans women of color who
have like been through the ringers in their lives, and give them a stage is still to this day one of the highlights of my life. Those were absolutely like some of the best things that I think we could have done.
I have a person and then an org that I think really helped me develop in my work. And as a person, my aunt growing up was only 8 years older than me, so we were very close. And I think she was always this, she also did theater, she was an actor in high school, which being not that far away from me, I saw her as something that was very other in my family. Just knowing that she could say what she meant when she meant it was really important for me, who as somebody who grew up trying to continuously make myself smaller for various reasons, just internalized racism and, you know, battling with what femininity looked like and didn't look like, there was always reasons that I wanted to be smaller and physically and vocally. And I think my aunt really helped me to just grow into a person who could use my voice coming from a place of truth and honesty to myself. So I think that just as a foundation was really, really important. And then the org that I worked for many years after college, The Unusual Suspects in LA, really helped me not only come into the like an arts administrator position, which I felt really helpful to learning what comprehensive like arts practices could look like, having people in positions where maybe it's not direct service right away to, we did youth programming. If you're not working in direct service with these people, what does it look like to be an administrator or a person sitting more behind the scenes and still being able to support them in ways that make sense and, you know, understanding their needs from a different point of view was really important for me to learn in that position. And then also being critical of, you know, when there was white leadership in positions where most of our kids were kids of color, and trying to learn what that meant in an org, and then me as a person of color in the org also working with those people, that's where I think I started to learn a lot of questions in terms of infrastructure of nonprofits and organizations, and thinking about what I could do to support what I wanted it to look like, or what I felt like could be more comprehensive in working with our participants.
Thank you. Grant, did you
have anything? Yeah, I mean, gosh, I have so many people, because I've just been working with so many artists over time, so it feels weird to name a singular person. Been making a lot of stories. I guess I'd name somebody recently. I've been following a long time the poetry of Claudia Rankine, and making a play with her right now, and there's just something about hanging out with somebody who has been speaking truth for a really long time that has been really inspiring in this particular moment. So she's on my mind, and but really just the, you know, the number of kind of playwrights and theater artists that risk every day these kind of, in a lot of ways, hard careers to tell stories that you know, have to be told. That's sort of what gets me up in the morning. So,
thank you.
Yeah, and I feel like a lot of you are touching on this thing around like, what does it mean to see yourself in other people in art? What does it mean to actually gain the skills to understand how these institutions function? And so something that I want to talk about, because a lot of what we talk about with breaking the binary, as much as it's around like inclusion for trans folks, it's also about acknowledging the spectrum of experiences and that there's both privilege and oppression, right? So I'd like to have a little bit of a conversation in asking, are there specific advantages or resources that you feel like you may have had that allowed you to get to the place you are? Because I think the thing that sometimes happens with theater a little bit is we don't actually talk about like how our individual identities actually allow us to have more privilege in spaces. Like myself, I was raised middle class, hell books in the house, read all the time. And even though I was never really exposed to art, I'm like, I know stories. I know how to talk a certain way. And I know that that gets me in the door in a way that some of my friends have hasn't. So I'd like us to have a little bit of a conversation about that, if that sounds good. Not everybody at once.
I guess I'll start. It's hard and confusing to talk about privilege in a way, personally. I'm a transracial adoptee, meaning I was raised in a house of people who are white, and I am Latina, and I'm also a transgender woman, and so I have a lot of the privileges that I've been afforded or had access to are like by proximity, but that does mean that like I've had a college education, that like I've been steadily employed for the majority of my life, and you know, that there's been health insurance and access to hormones and things, and like the being able to navigate those systems and structures of power are not as difficult for me. And I think in terms of my artist life, I think being seen and invested in and recognized as somebody within community, that there has been a certain like social capital that I receive and am very privileged to have. And that I think also that we don't necessarily always talk about or recognize. And so I am lucky to be here and like lucky to be on this panel. And there's like a bunch of other folks in the Bay who could also be here and like also be on this panel. And so yeah, just recognizing that, and that I just really believe in like building up other folks. And so recognizing that it's always important to like pay it forward and pass it on, and lift up our folks back home. So.
Awesome, thank you. Yeah, man, I would add to that. I feel like I sit in a lot of privilege. Most of my privilege has been institutional privilege over time. So, you know, advanced degrees and nonprofit. You know, the health insurance that comes with nonprofits, and you know, the institutional privilege of being in structures that provide some economic capacity. And certainly navigating institutions as a white person is always significantly easier than navigating institutions as a person of color. You know, the funny part about being trans and talking about privilege, you know, it's a kind of tortured, you know, conversation with yourself. I mean, for me, part of the way I feel like I was able to use privilege was by, you know, really waiting a long time to transition and doing it at a point when I thought I could survive it. Because honestly, I think part of being able to have privilege meant not transitioning, even though, you know, I knew many, many years ago, but knew that probably I wouldn't survive that. And so what you sort of see when you look around, and this is changing, but certainly from my generation, most of the people that transitioned when I was thinking about it the first time around was, you know, they immediately lost whatever privilege they had by the transition. They lost jobs, they lost community, they lost family, they lost. And so I purposely didn't make that choice. I mean, it's not a choice, but I purposely didn't allow myself to be myself in order to be privileged. So it's a funny, you know, it's a funny thing, all the things you give up to have some of the basics that you need. And so, you know, was able to sort of have the, you know, the sense that I would survive it a little bit later on. So I'm admiring of the people that are able to risk that sooner and really risk giving up privilege. And so, and it's interesting. I mean, even in the period of this where I, you know, I run an institution and you know, I sit in a lot of privilege. It's really interesting to have transitioned in that space and to watch the erasure that happens in that transitioning moment. So it's a really complicated topic. Yeah.
No, thank you. Yeah, I think there is something to be named about, like, what do you do when you're still trying to like get stable or get resources or survive? And so, and I think that's something that doesn't necessarily get explicitly talked about specifically like in witnessing in terms in front of cis people is like, why wouldn't people transition? And I think there's something where it's like, love yourself, it's your great. And it's like, it gets better mess without actually necessarily acknowledging the systemic challenges that people are facing that act as a barrier and like preventing people from speaking, from stepping into their truth. So yeah, thank you. Does anybody else want to touch on this question?
Yeah, I think in work and in life in general, I think for me, it's always about acknowledging as a light-skinned black person, how that looks differently in the world, and how that can be, people see me and there's a certain proximity to whiteness that exists there for them and for me in perception. And so I want to constantly acknowledge what that means in terms of employment, healthcare, just being able to have conversations and sit at certain tables with people, and how my voice could be perceived in those spaces. And so I think about that and how I can use those opportunities to take it back home and to like work for people who may not be sitting at the table, but who very well could be and also should be. And so I think about that and also the idea of having community and I think just having people who I know who could have my back in certain ways that I have access to in terms of, you know, financial or legal or medical. So just knowing that those things are in the back of my mind, even if I feel like I maybe, you know, I'm having a hard day and don't think I have those things, I actually do. So constantly checking myself and remembering the way that I walk and exist in the world is indicative of things that, you know, I may want to, may think I can ignore sometimes, but I cannot. And that even, I think, amounts to today, even like being here and thinking about how I got to this position is definitely, I think, part of those reasons.
Thank you. Does anybody else want to touch on this question? You don't have to.
So I know my privilege as I come from a supportive family. They're supportive of me from a very early age. And they've continued to be supportive, and I think that's something that needs to be acknowledged as, you know, I came out as a lesbian at age 16, and then I was like, all right, I'm done, figured it all out, 16 years old, got it all planned. But to have a family and a partner that is continually supportive of a changing identity, of continually questioning, is really a benefit that I know not everybody has.
So with that, I think what's coming up, what's I feel like so many folks are touching on in this moment is like the ways that intersectionality shows up for us, right? So like, how does the intersection of all of your identities, race, class, gender, physical ability, impact how we are perceived and what access to things we have? And so thinking about flipping that a little bit, I would actually, and I know folks have talked about this a little bit, so to the extent you went into detail, maybe a little bit less this time. As someone who, with your identity falling on a trans spectrum and also acknowledging all the intersectional ways that our identities show up, how do you think your identity has impacted your trajectory or experience in the arts field or specifically your artistic practice? I know everybody up here does a little bit of everything.
It makes me giggle because my family, I'm half Japanese. My family was so excited to hear I work at Harvard. I made it as an artist because I work at Harvard now, guys. And just sort of that idea of, that you can be Asian American and you can be Asian and do art is an interesting concept to some of my family members. So that's an interesting moment there.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I think my trans identity, I mean, it's like it's what makes me an artist, right? It's like it's what gives me, like, empathy. It's like what makes me listen to other, like, I'm a dramaturg and a producer. I spend a lot of my time just listening and thinking about what stories people are trying to tell. And I think it all comes from that deep sense of trying very much to see people and the stories they're trying to tell in as real and truthful a way as possible. So I feel like everything about my artistic practice comes from the sense I've had of being an observer to the world, I think it makes me good at what I do in that way. So I think I can't separate out kind of that. I can't separate those things.
Yeah. Oh, I guess I'm picking up the mic. I think I used to do drag very early on in my undergraduate career, and this was before RuPaul's Drag Race was a big thing. So I feel like a hipster drag queen at times, but it saved my life, being able to play and explore with gender, with a feminine side that I wasn't entirely familiar with. And that also became an isolating moment because trans women and drag queens like have a lot of combative moments, and there is a lot of tension between those two communities. And that is not something that like I have been able to practice or cultivate in my life. And something that like I had to give up as I transitioned, essentially. It's interesting the ways that like being trans kind of either pigeonholes you at times or opens up all these different doors that like you're not sure if you actually want to go through or not.
It's interesting. I'm trying to wrap my head around it, but the first thing that's coming to my mind is, for me, I feel like I live in this intersection of all these identities, right? But I feel like what most influences my work is my politics as someone who's living with all of this, right? So I've been trying to think like a little bit further than my identity, because I feel like I've been in so many spaces with people who share various points in this intersection, and I've been very upset, right? And I've been trying to figure out what is it about that tension. And I think it's like my politics are not simply just about like seeing myself. It's like, what is it about that need, right, to be validated as a whole person who deserves to be able to live your life in the world, right? And I think like for me, developing a politic that is radical, that is about freedom and liberation and abolition and like demilitarization, like, you know what I mean? Like to like go beyond my just like who I am in this body has really helped my work, because I feel like I now have way more depth to what I'm talking about, rather than it just also being centered in me and my intersections. You know, I feel like that is, I don't know, it's helping me also get beyond myself. I feel like there's just this moment, I feel like I've grown up in the middle of identity politics, like love and heaven, which, you know, has benefited me in many ways in terms of being able to be a part of programs that specifically target my intersections. But beyond that, I feel like I started to understand some of my frustration, you know, with being in those spaces. It's like, you know, when it was a huge thing to fight for marriage equality, why was I so angry, right? Why was I so oppositional? Because I knew in many ways that I wasn't reflected in a lot of the conversations that were happening, and that a lot of money was being donated to groups that were not checking for me and other brown, queer, homeless youth in New York City, right? And that was an urgent need. And I really tried to figure out how to like politically think about how to like infuse that into the work and not just say that it's about me being whatever identities, because it spans, you know?
Yeah. No, and I... Oh.
I think that's so interesting because personally, and I'm at a moment where I feel like I'm constantly having to choose which identity card I want to identify with. Like right now, like there's only, we only have enough room to talk about being a person of color or being genderqueer or something like that. So I feel like I'm constantly having to shift through these identities and pick up one to represent. And for me, that intersectionality is so important. So I think it's really interesting to how you move it outside.
You know, one of those like geometric shapes that you get from like Williams and Sonoma, you know, like those fancy stores or like at the airport, it's like there's no separating it from me, you know, like intersectionality is the life. You know, whether or not you come to terms with being a genderqueer, gender non-conforming trans person at 50 or 15, you're living in that, right? So for me, I just don't think that there's some sort of like stagnant experience of like, today I'm black, tomorrow I'm not black, today I'm trans. You know, it's just like I'm living and experiencing that maybe in consciousness or unconsciousness. I think really for me, it's more of that. And that's why I say about the politics, because that is really what has helped me. And when I enter a conversation, I can't negate those things, you know? So if I'm talking about blackness and otherness, my queerness is present. You know, the fact that I am an artist is present. And through consciousness, I want to name those things, right? Who I am and what I'm bringing to the table. But yeah, that's.
No, thank you. That's actually perfect. I won't lie. Like, I've joked with SK a lot that a lot of my facilitation style is tricking people. And so asking like really basic questions, I'm like, I know this is 101 and I know y'all are brilliant. And so you're going to take it to the next level. So I appreciate that. But I think like what you're bringing up, Nick, and like Kat, what y'all are talking about is what is beyond simply the representation, right? Because as somebody who like basically tried to turn a history major into ethnic studies and like some performance studies stuff because my school didn't have it, like looking at like the trajectory of like black theater over a century, right? Or looking at like queer theater and how do we move past simply, look, we're on stage, done. And specifically, not just to us as individuals or as artists, but really asking institutions to be like, what comes next? So I think like something about this weekend that was really exciting, like we were here, got to see Transcripts on Thursday, Peacock Rebellion on Saturday, and then Nick Kay's show, Little Black, last night, and seeing all of these things in a span of time and sitting in conversation with each other versus like only having one perspective. So I think what I wanna ask is, what changes do you think need to happen in arts institutions or in the field in general to move past simply just this representation? And what does it mean to actually for like trans artists, arts administrators, and cultural workers to really be deeply embedded and have that ideology and like what you were saying, Nick, like a politic, not just like identity, but the politic part of it present in their work?
Yeah, I have a strong opinion about that, having been around the not-for-profit theater for a long time, which is its economic viability. I mean, the thing that, you know, one of the things I really see about, I mean, it's really true for trans artists, and that the economic viability is so challenged that the capacity to really, have a life is almost impossible in the arts, and it's more difficult where you fall inside and outside of institutions, and I can't say enough, like we're doing just an ounce better at telling more complicated stories about a world that looks more like the actual world is. But if you look at the makeup of our institutions and who gets to actually have economic, any kind of economic stability, it is not queer and trans people, it is not people of color in those institutions, it is not, and I think that, and so what ends up happening is, we throw some, a little bit of, like, hey, come over and perform in the space, and, look at, we represented, and then people are like, yeah, but I don't have money to take the train home, right? And so, so I feel like this reality is so incredibly deep in our creative community. And I had the experience of gathering some trans folks in New York, and like just the lack of resources in the trans community, in particular trans and genderqueer, and that was it's just so profound. And so until we get some reality check on ourselves about that, because we're not lacking resources inside of these institutions. And so, but somehow those resources don't spread out. And so that to me is where, you know, one of the, I mean, there's more things, but that's one, that's a big one.
Yeah, I feel like it also just has to be beyond just the job, right? It's like you can't just be trying to answer these questions at work. They should be questions you're asking yourself when you're voting, at your community board meeting, whatever, right? Because it is just too easy, as you said, to program specifically when you're going to be thinking about these issues. They need to be integrated, right? Like, I often think, you know, when people say, like, why aren't there more roles? It's like, when I've stepped into classes at universities to share my work, very often if you look at the syllabi, when I am there or when another person is there is the only time they're talking about alternative stories or trans or GNC work, right? So you think, okay, in the university, we're not teaching these things or creating comprehensive room for these things. And if we are, it's still marginalized, but strategically centered. And then in the theater, we're doing very similar things. And I think whether we're talking about medicine, theater, art, whatever, it's like we can't continue to strategically be like, how do we do this in theater? It just needs to be in life. Because as you said, it's like before the trans or the GNC artist shows up, they're dealing with a lot of systemic issues, right? And it's like the theater can't solve in that one interaction, can't solve all of the what I'm bringing, right? But if you're actively involved in that, then you know what I mean? It's like a different conversation because you're fighting for me to be able to be a full, sustainable person, like, in the world, and the theater won't have to, you know, fork up $50,000, right, to change my life in this year, which, you know, a lot of times is what needs to happen, right? And that's a lot to ask from single engagement. So I think it really is about comprehensive, like, involvement in your life all the time. And that, for some people, is like, whoop, right? But it's just, like, what it needs to be.
Yeah, I think I think building off of what you've both said in terms of resources and comprehension, I have an example of the same org that I worked for, which was, you know, we did intergenerational programs, so parents would come with their young children and do these programs together, but we offered childcare. So if the child was under 5 years old and they weren't able to participate in the program itself, we had people who were on site who could, you know, they had activities and food and things for the younger children to be able to be there so that their parent or their caregiver could, you know, also take part in these theater programs, which in one way, it's like, yes, these are very siloed moments and experiences for these people, but just being able to understand the practice of thinking of what else might this person need in order to be able to sustain themselves today is a question that I think needs to be thought about more in terms of not just childcare, but, you know, the transportation question that you brought up, or different types of accessibility, whether it be physical or audio or visual, just wondering what other needs might people have that they might not openly or directly communicate, that I think we could be more critical and being more forward thinking about those things.
Yeah, there's something about, like, being, okay, I'm from the Bay, and so I'm gonna say something that's like super duper wooey. So I pulled a card this morning. Yes, I am that person. Like a tarot card this morning, for those of you that are like, what card? Like your business card? Like what? And it was talking about kind of like generosity of spirit, right? And so I think there's ways in which, as institutions, when folks are trying to build inclusion work, it's still trying to operate within the same model of how they normally do things. And part of it, I think what you're bringing up, Nick, is this idea of how do you do the thing before somebody has to ask you for it? Or how do you try to create space before somebody has to demand it of you? That feels super important to highlight.
The tough part at the same time is, you know, if you think about like administration and budgets, do you put in your budget like extra cash for those who have less and like POs? You know what I mean? It's like also structurally, what does that mean when you're talking to like the accountant, mm-hmm. you know, tax yeah. implications. Like that's, you know,
yeah.
so it's not, I know it's not easy, mm-hmm. right? So it's something that like we actually have to grapple with, mm-hmm. and it's not an easy thing. Do you say, oh, all cis white men will get less? And you're like, technically, like that is a form of discrimination, and yeah. like structurally, how do we grapple with those mm-hmm. sort of challenges? You know, and I know that it's real, so that's why I'm like, it's not as easy of an answer as like slash all of their budgets. You know?
Yeah, no way.
Yeah, I have a very boots on the ground perspective. Like, I work in production, so a lot of the time, it's sort of how do we take these bigger concepts of what we're trying to work on, and what does that look like at a load-in? Mm-hmm. And I think we did this training at the ART, and it was really exciting to hear that some of our production departments are starting to fold in gender identity into some of the forms that they send out, of just like they send out surveys to sort of take inventory of what your skills are. So like you're good loading in lights, or you can focus, but also including space to be like, and your preferred pronouns. Like that's an amazing step towards just a clue that if you're on that crew and you get some of that survey, that you'll suddenly say, oh, this is a place that is thinking about that, at least, that there's that thought work is being done. But I grapple a lot with how do you make a 50-person call more inclusive? How do you make that feel like a safe space? How do you make the one other person who is, you can tell is a person of color there, feel like they're included and safe in it? And that's a struggle for me.
Do you
want to
touch on that?
Yes and no. there's so many great pieces that are coming up in this conversation, mm-hmm. and it's, you know, I feel very blessed to be in the situation that I am as managing director of Peacock, because these are things that, like, we try and practice and mm-hmm. learn actively. And there's, like, the short-term harm reduction things around, like, okay, we always have ASL available at all of our shows. We always have a scent-free space mm-hmm. at our shows. We always have an accessibility coordinator and, you know, just all of these different things, and, like, are able to take requests around accessibility mm-hmm. and, like, are actively building out these programs centering Black folks and trans women of color, and especially Black femmes, and that is part of our vision for the future and the movement. And you know, integrating a liberation framework into our everyday work, and I think it is vital that there is these short-term plans with a long-term plan in mind of how are we gonna end this fucked up game that, like, we're all stuck in? And that, like, this shouldn't just be a career for one person, it should actually be, like, liberatory for all of us. And that is difficult and hard and not easy to even think about or conceptualize. But that this is a great first step of coming to the symposium. And yeah, I'm learning and like making space for other folks and challenging yourself around that. But yeah, I think everybody had really amazing points.
I was gonna say, yeah, just another thing that I realized, that I've come to a point where I have a little bit more power in the situation that I'm in. I'm a production manager, and I'm enjoying getting to disrupt the network of, like, these are the four designers we use every year. They do all the shows. And that's it. And taking a chance to be like, no, we're going to look at other people, and we have a chance to be more diverse in our choices, and we have a chance to bring new people into our network. And I think that's a really great thing I've discovered that I can do.
Yeah, I know. So thank you. Y'all are so brilliant. Like, I just need to stop. Like, I was like, I want to take notes. You're supposed to be facilitating. I want to take notes. And so I'm like, but it's great that it's live streamed, because then I can go back and look at it and listen to things and be like, that thing. So I think the last thing I want to add on, and I know this was the question that I said, I was like, I might add something, this is the one. Considering, and I think this, like several of you, I think like Lexi and Nick, you both touched on this like really, really deeply, of like, this cannot just be work that happens at your day-to-day job. Like, it has to actually be about building liberation as a whole, because yeah, our institutions by themselves cannot change the world. they cannot save someone's life by themselves. But if you are invested in freedom and liberation for everybody, then your institution, like the folks that you're working with and you're trying to support and engage their art, therefore benefit. So I guess a question that I have is, like, aside from, like, just inclusion within the arts institutions, what type of general practices do you think that, like, either institutions or individuals should be doing to contribute, like, to fight against the oppressive practices that are happening, and specifically some of the regime that's happening now?
Yeah. I think something that I've thought about a lot is, like, thinking about districts that you don't, that's not just your own district, you know, like community boards that's just not your own community board, the schools that other children go to, not just your children, you know, because it's hard, right? Like, you're trying to, like, sustain yourself and your family and your life, and it's hard for all of us. Like, if you have privilege, yes, but, like, on a day-to-day basis, we're all dealing with challenges, and that's different, right? So I would say that is something, like, think beyond your own situation. Understand how legislation affects people other than you, right? So if you're like, oh, I'm not Muslim, right? And for some people, that's enough, right? It's like, finally, I'm not a part of the targeted group. So I think that's, like, really important, and it's hard. I'm like, I have a list of websites that I check. There's, like, really comprehensive material going out around right now about, like, who your senators are, who your congressmen are. I wrote them in my notebook of, like, my daily to-do list. You know, just, like, things that, like, normally I'd be like, somebody else is handling that, right? Like, I'm doing this. I'm, like, I know my community organizations that I'm working with and I'm donating to that do the work that I care about. But I'm like, actually, I need to move beyond just, like, you know, the LGBT black artists and poets and, like, brujas that I hang out with, and expand, you know, myself a little bit to seeing what else is happening. Really random, I never think about people in rural areas. I'm a city person all the way. I've born and raised. But I was reading some texts about rural areas and the sort of stereotyping of the demographics in those areas. And thinking, like, I've met in all the time I've been doing art, I've met a lot of trans and GNC people who are in rural areas, and I'm not thinking, right, when I'm making these decisions and when I'm looking at legislation about how these things will specifically affect those people and what organizations are there that they can reach out to. That would be a really great place for me to fund, right? Maybe instead of giving all my money to the ACLU, who other people most likely will give to. So I think, you know, that is a sort of practice that I'm trying to cultivate more in this time.
That is absolutely great. I do know that we are getting close. So if folks could keep the answers succinct so everybody can touch on them, that would be great. I'm also bad at that, so I'm gonna stop talking.
I was just, something that I've been thinking about a lot lately has been encouraging people to think again into the personal as political. Your small choices can have a political meaning and can be politically empowering. To, like, the point of, you choose to be part of a CSA, that money is going to a local farmer that is supporting a local community. Like, to realize that even small choices can be empowering, or that small choices have political impact, and to really drill down into the choices you make every day.
I wish I had a list of, like, 10 things that you can do to, like, be a better person, but I don't. So I think that I will say that this is a hard time for all of us. This is also new to many of us who, I think especially, like, younger folks who aren't familiar with living in a repressive fascist regime. And so learning really about the ways that things are rapidly shifting, and what that's gonna mean in the short term and long term for all of us. And I agree with both what everyone said so far and the personal's political. And I also think it is really important to push ourselves to get to, I don't know if it's that next level or, you know, kind of the next stage for you, what that might look like in terms of making space or devoting time and energy to folks that are really being targeted right now, but also dedicating and devoting yourself to like a long-term vision or dream of what our lives can look like, and what our liberation and freedom can look like, and especially listening and supporting those visions and dreams of like Black folks especially. And challenging the ways that like we do our everyday work to make it more accessible, make it more intentional, and just, yeah, resist.
I feel like everybody's had really great points up until now. I think that for me, I guess I'll speak personally for me, has been really about thinking kind of how Nick's been, you know, making a point of it, making it beyond myself and the identities that I know of, that I've experienced, and that I've walked through the world with, and really paying attention closer. I know that I've paid closer attention to this election and this political situation, more so than any other before. And like on a daily basis, figuring out where to go to get what information, and really trying to challenge myself to, you know, when I've read that article and I've thought about that question and then close the computer, or taking it a step further and then going and having a conversation with somebody about that, and really thinking about the implications of a certain piece of legislation or a certain community who might be impacted that's not me and that's not the ones that I come from. And then asking those people, because I always want to, like, you know, think about the balance between like asking the oppressed to educate me and also wanting to hear the voices of those people. So there's that certain balance too that I try to think about, is how to get the information from those voices without feeling like it's extra work for them. So I think that's a really important thing that I'm trying to keep focus on, is that I need to get it somehow. And that's up to me to figure it out, because it's important for me to figure out how to resist and support the resistance of communities that are not necessarily mine. And maybe, you know, having faith that somebody from another experience will also have my back in this moment and next whatever few years as well.
I just add, at HowlRound we talk a lot about commons-based practice, which is really just a fancy way of talking about resource sharing. So I think it's a really great time for us to be just kind of assessing the resources we have and figuring out how those resources are useful, helpful in an impossible political scenario. And so, you know, for me, I'm just always thinking about, like, you know, I just went through a process of doing all the hell of changing your name and gender on everything, and like, so how do I share all that with everybody I know, because it's like a terrible, terrible process, and long and confusing and overwhelming. And so I feel like, you know, always I'm trying to think about what do I know that can be helpful right now, in a really critical time for people who are at risk. And you know, even I think simple things like my spouse and I over the years have done a thing called family dinners for our friends, which we haven't done in a while. And like, it's like a really important time, like, to have family dinners again. Like, just like, how do we all come together? And, you know, we can all cook, or we can all share a meal. Or so I think it's big, it's big stuff, and it's really just simple stuff, because we sort of we really need the connection of one another right now. So.
Word. Well, I just want to give it up for our panelists. And just highlight a couple of specific action things that I heard to close us out. So the personal small impact, what is the thing that you individually can do day to day so that we can impact change? Fighting for and paying attention to communities other than yourself. What's the whole quote? By the time they came for me, there was no one left to fight. And then also just, you know, be a good human. Think about someone other than yourself and your own folks. Talking to our people to get them to do the same thing.
which becomes that individual thing, those conversations that as much as it might seem like work and effort, I know I've been having a lot of talks with family, can make a big old difference. And then I think just remembering that we are the ones that we've been waiting for. So thank you all so much. And I think I'm gonna invite SK up. Y'all are welcome to sit here and look pretty. You're welcome to go get back to some seats. Well, let's pop it up one more time.
Yeah, we're just gonna close it out real quick and say goodbye to the live stream, the HowlRound audiences. Thanks so much
for
tuning in. If you're watching this in the future, you know, hey.
Hello from, goodbye from the past.